Mike Muse is an industrial engineer, a music executive, a political architect. He breaks down the intersection of politics and pop culture. This is the Mike Muse Show.
What's up, brothers? It's your boy, Mike Muse. Welcome to another episode of the Mike Muse Show. I am so excited that you decided to join me this evening to have this fascinating conversation. Listen, this is going to be a really dope show today because I'm going to bring together these two fantastic guests, and I think they are the most smartest people in the entire world that is dealing with film, sports, and entertainment, man. My first guest that we have coming up, super smart, Mr. Reginald Hudlin. I have been a fan of his for so long. Reginald, you don't understand, brother, how excited I am to be in conversation with you. Your film that you made, House Party, was absolutely insane. It was amazing. But it's really Boomerang. Boomerang is really what got me to actually move to New York City. Literally watching Marcus Graham interact in his loft in Soho. I think it was in Soho, but in his loft in Soho, doing his thing, man. I was like, you know what? Coming from Michigan, I want to move to New York City and get that loft, brother. But you are one of the most smartest people that I know, the most creative individuals that I know. And I'm so excited that you're in studio with me today. We're going to talk a little bit about the current film that you have on Netflix, a docu-film, The Black Godfather, man. And to me, that was a smart film. There was a lot of science and technology in there, man. So I want to do a deep dive into you. But yo, listen, welcome to the show, brother. I'm so happy that you're here today.
Hey, everybody.
Yo, Reginald, it's so good to have you in the studio with me, man. You are just absolutely amazing. You have...
Very kind of you.
You know, sometimes music is always, we say, the soundtrack of our lives, right? Mm-hmm. But your films have been the narrative of like completely of like my upbringing, things I enjoy, the really great memories that I have, all the way from Boomerang to House Party. I mean, you name it, all the way up to where we are now with The Black Godfather, brother. So thank you for your gift of artistry.
Thank you
for being a custodian of culture and what you do to advance it. Mm-hmm. And to really make sure that you bring it to the fullness of who we are with such range. And so I really appreciate that. As you think about your work, is that something that you're intentional when you think about your project that you select?
Yes, I do, actually, because I just feel like part of it is I always want to zag when other people zig. Mm-hmm. And I just feel like, wow, there's a thing I call the burden of history, whereas there's all these great stories that haven't been told, yeah. Right? And whether it's the lives of teenage kids just wanting to have a party, or, you know, back in the old West and people, you know, fighting for your love in a place of oppression, or a mogul that no one's heard of but is behind every cool thing in the last 50 years.
Yeah.
So I'm like, wow, this is, no one else is making that movie. This is a story that needs to be told. And I feel like I'm uniquely qualified to tell it. So those are kind of my criteria.
I love how you said tell stories that have not been told, because I am a big advocate of that. You know, I believe there's room and space for all narratives. Mm. And sometimes I get really frustrated when we begin to tell the same narratives over, or we celebrate the same heroes over, and we should, and they should get their flowers. And I understand that too as well. But there's so many unsung heroes that go unnoticed, right? That if we were to see more and expose what it could be. Case in point, my personal life is Boomerang. So the reason why I literally moved to New York City is because of the film Boomerang, and I wanted to have a loft just like Marcus Graham did in the Boomerang, and I didn't see like this black man existing in that space, and so it really was my benchmark for who I am and where I wanted to be, and it literally got me here.
That's a great story. You know, it's fun. There's actually an organization called the Marcus Graham Group.
With Lincoln Stevens.
Yeah.
He's great, man.
And when he told me about it, I was like, wow, this is fantastic. And he says, no, we've gotten so many black folk to go into advertising because they want to get their Marcus Graham on.
Yeah.
So does that mean you have a bed that rotates and has a...
See, Russ, I'm not there yet. I'm not there yet. I don't think I want the bed that rotates. But I definitely want that loft. I'm yet to get the loft space, but I know you guys did shoot in Soho. At least theoretically, I believe.
It's funny, that apartment is a commercial space, and they shoot a lot of commercials and stuff there.
Oh, you tricked me.
Yeah, we tricked you.
Oh my God. I literally like moved like a few blocks away from Soho.
I'm
getting close to my dream here.
Well, you are, because it is downtown. So you're not wrong. You're in the right neighborhood.
Calls my landlord, cancels lease. goes to find another one, man. And also, too, in terms of what you've done within the award space, you know, I had the chance to attend the 50th anniversary of NAACP Image Awards this past time, and what that award show has done was absolutely phenomenal. And I've been to it a few times before, and I've been to other award shows, too, obviously, but there was something about this year of celebrating just the breadth and dynamic of who we are. As you begin to take on a project like that, how are you starting from that place, right? Like, do you just throw all Black excellence on the board and then choose in terms of like a Venn diagram, or is there a flow chart, if-then statement?
Well, you know, that was my seventh year doing the show. And that very much was my agenda. Like, how do we, you know, how do we celebrate the breadth of what we do? Not just that we do this well or that well, but look at all these kind of things we do well, right? Whether it's in drama and comedy and music and film and television and politics. So you go, okay, how, you know, and how do we make sure we're constantly mixing up the faces that we're celebrating? Because it's very easy to go to kind of a bunch of easy go-tos. You know, you just want to put people, you go, whoa, we went from there to there in the space of 5 minutes, and there's an exhilaration that comes from seeing it all mashed up and just going, and we all love each other. We're all happy for each other.
Your properties and what the project you choose to work on always have like an interesting social construct. There is a politicalness to it, but not overtly, right? Is that a formula that you have? Is that part of like your secret sauce where it's not dead smack in your face, but there is things you begin to think about as a narrative is moving forward?
I think people want protein with their meal, right? They want something meaty that they can think about, talk about on the way home. But you know what? If it's not tasty, if it doesn't have a lot of flavor to it, then you're not going to eat it. So entertainment first. Entertainment first and last. But that entertainment has got to be fueled by the plutonium of something important to say. Because if not, it's not must-see viewing. Right? A really important something is that, no, you need to see that. That's going to affect your daily life. You know, a really effective piece of entertainment is a blueprint for living. So you just go, oh, that's how you talk to your kids about grades, or that's how you deal with a bully, or that's how you overcome any kind of obstacle, you know, whatever it may be. Like, what are you giving people, right? Because they're giving you $15. That's a lot of money.
That is.
Two tickets.
Popcorn.
Popcorn. They make, and it may be a date.
It might dinner be, before, after.
There might be some hair did.
Facts. And the fresh lineup. The Caesar.
So you, so my thing is, when you watch a movie, right, there's a meter, like a taxi meter, right? You, how fast do you get your $15 back? Like, the meter's going in reverse. And my thing is, you should get your $15 back by halfway. And then everything else is money back. In terms of entertainment value, you go, yo, that was good. I got my money's worth plus. So I always have that strong sense of value, because where I came from, East St. Louis, a small town in the Midwest, I remember I'd be lying in a diner and they go, I want some white soda water. And you go, what does that mean? Sprite. And the thing is, don't put too much ice in it. Like, don't try to cheat me out my white soda water by filling the cup up with ice. So Black people are very value minded. So I make movies for that person who doesn't want too much ice in their soda.
I love where you're going with this, because I'm also a fellow Midwesterner. I'm a Michigander. And so I'm very familiar with that Midwest lingo, but I'm just listening to you now, and you have a way of language. I love how you did Fueled by Plutonium as a nuclear chemical researcher back in the day. That really speaks to me and resonates with me, right? And your ability to do easy conversation is palpable, but understanding different segments of the market, right? And understand how that works. So when you are, do you think about how a story develops to you, right? Because clearly you have ability to pen, right? And you're very loquacious, right? Like, is that part of the constitution, really developing strong characters through language in terms of how does this character speak?
I mean, you have to. And And making sure you have a range of characters, mm-hmm. whether in Boomerang, it's Eddie, David, and Martin, mm-hmm. right? Those three different men. But you get why those three men all hang out and why they enjoy each other. Mm-hmm. And they have different worldviews. But when you watch that, you go, yeah, that's me and my boys.
Yeah.
Now, you may argue which one you are, but you identify with them.
Yeah.
You know, when people see, you know, Hallie and Robin in that movie, they go, well, I relate to Hallie, but I want to be Robin.
Yeah.
You know, I've heard women say that to me.
Yeah.
So you just go, look, just because I just literally love the whole range of who we are mm-hmm. and have no problem celebrating the whole range of who we are. Mm-hmm. So just putting that all out there, you know, people go, oh, that is like my life because that's what our lives are.
Yeah.
We know somebody who lives in the projects. Yeah. We know someone who lives in a penthouse. We know someone who lives in a working class house.
Yeah.
And we're all friends. We're all cousins.
Yeah.
And you know, if something bad happens, we could all be in the projects.
Yeah, absolutely.
Or, you know, we could get our act together and all move to a penthouse.
Yeah.
You know, these are our lives.
Yeah. It's interesting to hear you talk about that and also see why you started a record label back in the day. because music is always a soundtrack. I kind of started that off in the conversation, music being the soundtrack of our lives, right? Mm-hmm. There's something about good writing where it makes you feel relatable, right? And that's the power of music. That's why we enjoy going to the concert experience, right? There's this feeling like this singer gets me, or this writer really penned something that really speaks to my moment and to my existence. And so I see the mashup of between just pop culture and properties of entertainment, right? Music and film and speaking the language.
Well, music is to me the highest level of sophistication in terms of artistic expression, maybe period, but certainly in the Black community, mm-hmm. right? I mean, whether it's, you know, a Miles Davis track or Chance the Rapper or Smokey Robinson,
yeah.
there's someone to express how you feel yeah. in very specific terms
yeah.
at any given time. We can find the song to express that unique feeling you have.
Mm-hmm.
So my challenge as a filmmaker is, how can we reach the greatness of Miles Davis, of Smokey Robinson, of Kanye West, these guys who are so great at taking our thoughts and feelings and expressing them into these 3-minute poems.
Yeah.
And you just go, okay, how do we get there? How do we get to that level?
Yeah.
So that's always my chance. And of course, we get the advantage of using that music.
Yes.
That's what I loved about movies. As a kid, I said, wait a minute, movies include all of the seven arts, right?
Yes.
It's literature, it's architecture, it's music, it's color, and it lasts the longest.
Yep.
And it pays the most.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm doing that.
And it helps push the emotional connectivity to it, right? In
yes.
terms of the dramaticness of the effect, whether it's a psycho thriller, whether it's a love moment, whether it's intense, right? The orchestra music that kind of exists, right? Music for me in film has always been a secondary character, if not at moments, primary characters, right?
Absolutely.
Which is why I love talking to directors more mm. than actors, is because, I love talking to actors.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I love you guys, right? but there's something about a director where you speak to the decision points of why, right? And I love getting to the constitution of the why, which brings me to my next round of this conversation as we move forward along with this new film that you directed, the documentary, I should say,
mm-hmm.
The Black Godfather, out on Netflix right now, but mm-hmm. Claire Zavant. It is absolutely fantastic and amazing. And I understand why it's been resonating so well with the viewing audience, right? Because Clarence was this individual who was both operating in the music space and in the film space. And so for you to be the director of that, and now understand your constitution of mm-hmm. coming, understand what music is, right? What music is to film, but then also too, coming from the film industry, who better than you to direct? I get why it came out so poignantly. Why was it important for you to unlock his story when it came to doing this docu-film?
I feel that Clarence represents a giant chunk of Black history that's never been told.
Mm-hmm.
And because he is an influencer who has no desire to be famous,
mm-hmm.
you know, it took us a long time to convince him to make. Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, you're just like, I'm a baller, I'm an influencer, I'm
yeah.
this, you know, and, you know, we tie celebrity with influence.
Yeah.
And what he's the living example of, not only can you be incredibly influential and not be famous, part of your power comes from not being known.
Mm-hmm.
right? Because people who are in the celebrity business go, wait a minute, this guy doesn't want what I have. You know, he could.
Yeah.
You can't be friends with that many famous people and not be famous unless you make a very clear decision not to.
Yeah.
So they go, wow, well, he's very powerful and he's very confident that he doesn't want that thing that we all fight for so much.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And then on top of it, he's not sweating us for money.
Yeah.
So like, you don't want fame. You're not sweating me for money, but you clearly look like you got money. You got your beautiful home, yeah. and you know, you're, you know, eating in the fancy restaurants. So like, you don't need what I'm scrapping for. Yeah. So you're on another level. And it's like, yes, it's exactly what he is. He's yeah. on another level.
So let's just go to one, because there's so many things I want to break down. The documentary, it was very powerful. And it speaks to me from numerous different places, especially coming from the fundraising aspect of politics. And mm-hmm. so it was also on President Obama's National Finance Committee. Mm-hmm. And I believe within the finance realm and space is where really decisions and influence could be made mm-hmm. when you're in that space. And so I have a special appreciation for what he was able to do to pave the way for mm-hmm. individuals like me mm-hmm. to want to be able to enter this space, mm-hmm. right? And kind of laying out the blueprint of kind of what it is. But I'm interested in this notion of language that we've been kind of harping on, because mm-hmm. he has a use of language that is uniquely his own. Mm-hmm. He's very unapologetic about it. And I'm curious, do you think that had anything to do with the success that he was able to have in mm-hmm. entering into spaces, right? And then making, when he entered in the room, making it count.
Mm-hmm.
Can you speak to that?
Sure. Well, I mean, being clearly, Clarence is authentic,
yeah.
right? And he's not, he's the opposite of code switching,
mm-hmm.
right? Yeah. He's true north. This is who I am. This is how I talk. This is what I think. I'm never withholding my feelings, right? If I'm mad at you, I'll let you know. Mm-hmm. If I'm happy, I'll let you know. I mean, I don't express happiness that much, but you know, I'll express it, yeah. you know, you'll get it. And so look, I think right now, politically, culturally, authenticity is so important. And I feel like he was kind of ahead of his time in terms of, you know, being that true north authentic character.
Mm-hmm.
And his rawness, you know, the fact that like, you know, if he's setting a meeting at the White House, he's cursing.
Yeah.
So you just go, wow, you just don't care. It's like, I don't care. Mm-hmm. None of you are enough of anything to make me change who I am.
Mm-hmm.
So the confidence and power that comes from that.
Yeah.
And, you know, his business, his conversation is always transactional.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when he went and confronted the head of Coca-Cola.
Which is a brilliant story.
He did not say hello.
Yeah.
Right? He pulled up to the table. And he was as close to the desk as the head of Coca-Cola was.
Yeah.
So he co-opted his physical space.
Yeah.
I said, this is my desk now.
Mm, that's amazing.
Right? And
that's amazing.
Then
that's amazing.
He started negotiating with the very first word.
Yeah.
So the guy said, oh, this guy cares not about rules
yeah.
on any level.
Mm-hmm.
He did not have an appointment. He just walked into my office and started negotiating. Who does that?
Who does that? But again, that goes to language, right?
Yes.
And that goes to the authenticity of it all. And we all have our language that we communicate and that we speak, but also goes to the pickup to where you were just saying that he did it not for wanting money, right? Because that seemed to be repetitiveness of it too as well. Like, he wasn't asking for a fee. There was no retainer fee.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you do projects that you really believe in and mm-hmm. the authenticity of it,
mm-hmm.
that's how you get the results of it.
Right.
I know we have to conclude very shortly right now, but something I just found really interesting, and I love your, I'm curious about the decision points, was your use of the node visually
yes.
In the documentary, because when it was coming together, I didn't understand what was happening. I'm like, the visual, I'm like, what is this,
mm-hmm.
right? But in the end, it reached this beautiful puzzle came together of the nodes, right? Like, why does your use of the node? I'm seeing plutonium with you. Talk to me a little bit about that.
Yeah, you're exactly right. Because, I mean, we knew we had to find a visual metaphor to express
yeah.
the man, because the life and the relationships are so complex. So first we started with a family tree.
Yeah.
And we're like, oh, there's roots and there's branches. And that doesn't really get it. So we're looking at different images. Then we saw an Indian mandala.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, now we're hitting on the metaphor.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's the sun.
Yeah.
And they, all these people around her are planets, and those planets have moons, mm-hmm. right? And you can look at it on a cosmic level or on a molecular level.
Yes.
Right?
That's what I was looking at, yeah.
Either way, it works. And
it
the
does,
fact that
yeah.
molecular and cosmic are
they're the same.
Right. So that said everything that needed to be said.
Yeah.
Like, okay, this is who this guy is, and this is how it works. And yes, when you're up against it, you can't see it.
Yeah.
But when you actually, 2 hours later, when you get the big picture of the who the man is,
yeah.
then suddenly the grand scheme of it all
yeah.
and the beauty of all these disparate elements are all, of course, there's symmetry and there's beauty.
Yeah.
And it's like, it just seemed like a crazy mess.
Yeah.
It's not.
It was so powerful. And it goes to that whole mysterious of, you know, what is, the question of was, who is he? What does he do? Just a conversation I had about, what is this node? What is this about? So you did it perfectly in keeping us on that ride of still questioning who he is by wondering and questioning what this node was about, brothers. Listen, Reginald Hudlin, I can talk to you all day. Clearly, you have to come on and talk Iran nuclear deal with me. the next time you come up, man.
I've got opinions.
I think it's the same, man. Thank you for being such a great example of culture. Thank you for advancing our narratives, and thank you for finding such incredible unsung heroes and stories to really highlight, Reginald. It's been a pleasure talking with you.
Same here. Yeah. Thank you so much, man.
Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, stay right there, and I'll be right back.
You're listening to the Mike Muse Show.
On the old town road, I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse through the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more.
I got the horses in the back.
You're listening to the Mike Muse Show.
Thank you for joining us back for the Mike Muse Show, man. And listen, I'm not going to disappoint you. That conversation was really, when we landed, was nothing but science and technology and physics and nodes and nuclear research and nuclear energy, man. I told you, today is about smartness. Today is about this intersectionality of all things smart, all things cool, and my next guest is not disappointing. I've been a fan of this brother on the field and now off the field, Mr. John Urschel, the NFL football player from the Baltimore Ravens, who has decided, man, to go back and get his PhD from MIT, brother. This brother is all things smart, all things technology. And I thought it was such a great coupling to the conversation, man, that we were just having. John, I'm so excited to have you on the phone with me, brother. I have been a fan of yours for some time. It was really incredible to watch you on the field, to watch you do your thing, man, and to know that you have actually decided to pursue what your curiosity and what your passion is, which is math, brother. Like, listen, I tried 4 semesters of calculus, man, and could not do it. But anyways, enough of me. More about you, John. What's up, John? Welcome to the Mike Muse Show, boy.
Hey, I'm doing well. How are you?
Brother, I'm doing great, man. I'm so happy to be in conversation with you. We have so many intersections that you may not even know about, man. One, I'm a Big Ten guy, so I went to the University of Michigan. But I at Penn State, you know, Big Ten family, man. So I was super cool about that. And I'm a geek at heart, brother. I have my engineering degree from University of Michigan, and I did nuclear chemical research, brother, for 3 years. So I love all things math and science.
Gotcha. That's awesome. Yeah. All right. You ready to get it started?
Yeah, man. So you wrote a book that you have a book out right now that you're going to talk about, Mind and Matter, A Life in Math and Football. I just want to know, John, before we even get into the book, before we get into everything, I was reading up on your bio and your story, and I was reading something that you were auditing calculus classes while you were 13 years old. Is that true?
Yeah. I mean, I had a free summer, and my father, you know, he was going back to school. He was retired, getting his master's in economics from UB, and he just let me audit a class in his name. And it was really enjoyable for me. I have to say, like, when people hear that, they think it's kind of crazy, but I think you can sort of maybe connect with this.
Yeah.
Calculus, in many ways, isn't that hard. Like, people hear the word calculus, and they think it's like a synonym for, like, really, really tough. But in many ways, like, calculus is one of the most natural math classes you'll take, because everything really makes sense, everything starts to become connected, and everything starts to become connected to the world we live in a serious way.
Says the guy who's majoring in mathematics, pursuing his PhD at MIT. I did the whole like four semesters of calculus, man. And when I was going through it, man, it was very challenging. But to your point, what I think what people are afraid of when it comes to mathematics is they don't look at it as a language, right? And when you are able to look at math as a language, you begin to understand it a little bit easier, right, in terms of how it connects. And you're right. I actually thought that calculus is actually a beautiful type of math, right? And the way it was written and the integrals and how you began to even just write it, man, I thought that was wild. But I don't know if I would have been 13 years old finding that fun and fascinating. What do you think about your curiosity that drew you to math as a child?
I don't know what it is. I've always been sort of a curious person, even when I was young, and I always ask the question, why? Mm-hmm. And this is what drew me to mathematics, is sort of seeing a problem and wanting to sort of understand it, understand what's going on, how do I solve this, to see a math formula and understand, why is this the formula? How did we get here? And this is what really led me to excel in mathematics.
Yeah. So then how then the intersection of football come into play, right? Because in one regard, one would think that they're totally polar opposites, but in another regard, they share a very symbiotic relationship. So at what point then did you start pursuing your football career? Was that in high school?
Yeah, so it was in high school, but I was interested in football in some way sort of my whole childhood, because my father played college football at the University of Alberta. And I just really wanted to be just like him.
Nice. that's awesome, man. And then you end up going to Penn State, man, the Nittany Lions, yep. And which is an incredible stadium. I haven't been to the stadium yet. That's one of the places I want to go, especially for the whiteout that you guys do. That stadium is rocking when you guys are rocking. Mm-hmm. You're all white, man. Like, what was that like, man, just being a college football athlete at a historic program like Penn State, rushing through the tunnel, onto the field, you hear the music blaring and bumping?
Oh, it was absolutely amazing. I mean, okay, the tradition is just, it's just insane. But, even more than the tradition, just Penn State as a university was an amazing place. I mean, these were some of the happiest years of my life, going to school there, studying math, playing football. I mean, college football was actually my favorite time playing football, just playing ball with my best friends in front of 106,000 fans. Repping my university, the place that I call home. It was just it was an amazing time in my life.
Which is why I prefer college football over the NFL. I love the NFL, but there's nothing like a fall Saturday, right? When you get a chance just to watch football, either in person or just on television. I think it's because of the players like you. There's such a passion on the field that's completely different than the passion on the field in the NFL. And I think that the students are really playing for so much more, for the alma mater, for the legacy, everyone's friends, right? And everyone's playing their heart out and leaving on the field. I think that's what's fascinating, man. At what point were you ever, and I know when you got to, when you're playing in the NFL, there became a decision point, but did you have this wrestling in your mind about what to do? Was it NFL always the goal, or were you actually curious about pursuing math as well full time and opting out?
I was very curious about pursuing math full time. I mean, the NFL didn't really become a thing until later in my college career, and I got to admit, like when I was younger, like when I, before I got to college, my dream was to be a Big Ten offensive lineman. Mm-hmm. This is what I dreamed of. When I was a kid, I would watch Michigan every Saturday and I wanted to be just like Jake Long.
Oh yes, I love Jake Long. Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I was a left tackle in high school, and this was my idol. So
he killed that position as left tackle.
Oh, he was a monster. Yeah. And yeah, I mean, me being an offensive lineman at Penn State, getting all Big Ten honors my last 2 years, I mean, this was my dream come true.
Yeah. I can only imagine, man, for that to be the dream, especially following that career of Jake Long, for somebody who's kind of helped redefine that position and what that position looked like, man. And then we're sort of the NFL, and you were the Baltimore Ravens. And I think that, when I started hearing your story, was when you were at Baltimore, and then I knew that you were leaving to go to MIT. And I'm like, is this guy crazy? Like, he is the craziest, smartest, stupidest person I know that I don't know. like, who gives that up to go to MIT and study math, man? But did you get that a lot from your friends and from your family as you was making that decision?
No, I think everyone who knew me, everyone who knows me, completely understood.
Yeah.
And thought, like, why did it take this long?
Oh, I love that. Why did it take this long?
Why did it take this long? Get over at MIT. Get your math career going and, like, really pursue, like, what you're best at.
Yeah, that's awesome. I think because you don't hear that right too often, right? Because for most people, to go to NFL is the end-all, be-all, and the get, right? And for you and those who know you best knew that that wasn't the end-all, be-all for you. Where you were destined was in academia, right, and math. And I think that's brilliant. I think that's a story to pull out, right, in terms of even when we think something is perfect and ideal, to always keep searching, right, and always be curious about something because you're destined. Destination could be in a whole completely different another space and place. That's beautiful, John. So now that you're at MIT, man, what do you hope to pursue? Like now that when you get your PhD, are you want to go into academia? Do you want to be a professor?
Yeah, man, life is good. I've got one more year left at MIT. I'm going into my fifth year, which is about how long these PhDs take, 5 to 6 years in math, and getting ready to hit the market this fall and. I'm looking forward to being a professor, doing research, solving like really cool and tough and interesting open math problems.
Yeah.
But also to teach and try to inspire young people using math. Like I'm just, I have to admit, I'm really excited.
I know. And following this perspective when it comes to using STEM, artificial intelligence, big data, predictive analysis when it comes to sports. Particularly, I've been doing a deep dive lately into the MLB, into baseball, and how baseball is using AI and big data in order to assess the speed of pitching and also, too, in terms of in the power hitting and where to place the outfielders, right, based upon predictive analysis from the data that's been acquired. So I'm actually leveraging AI and big data and math on in a routine basis. To really advance this narrative of AI and future of work. So I know you have an interest in that space in terms of how football uses math, right, and data in order to assess plays. Can you talk to us a little bit about how you look at that perspective of how STEM could be an asset and a coupling to the NFL?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, at its core, football is a very sort of strategic game. And there's a lot of decisions involved. And any sort of time you have some strategic game with a lot of decision-making, mathematical and quantitative analysis becomes extremely useful. And this is becoming more and more popular. And I think that, we've only scratched the surface, and there's going to be a lot more math used in football. And it's going to get closer and closer to sort of like the ways in which the MLB sort of really uses a lot of mathematics. I mean, it'll never be on that level because the MLB is just so sort of well-suited to mathematical analysis, but the use of analytics in football is definitely sort of heating up. And
also, too, in basketball, as well. Basketball, NBA is also using mathematical analysis and statistics, which is why you see the game of basketball transitioning. I'm not going to say it's completely transitioning, but you're seeing more strength to perimeter shooting, jump shots versus going to the hole because there is a predictive analysis on shot percentages, right, and location and placements of the players. But I do think that there is a space when it comes to at least a play calling in football. Would you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. I completely agree, and it's interesting stuff. Although I have to say that this isn't really something I see myself doing in the future. I do think these are interesting problems.
Yeah, they are. But you want to be more in the classroom. And I love the idea of you being in the classroom because what I find most interesting when I went further in math was the proofs of math, right? For me, that was actually more difficult because there was more words involved than actually with numbers. And so I love the idea of you as a professor being able to teach all that. That aspect, if you will, of mathematics. So why did you decide to write the book, Mind and Matter? Talk to us about like the inspiration. Did you wake up one day? Were you taking a shower? Were you driving down the car and was like, I want to write a book?
It was sort of a slow buildup. I sort of felt more and more a desire to sort of share mathematics, share my love of mathematics, my journey with mathematics. And that's where this was born out of. And, it sort of became apparent that I can't talk about my journey with mathematics and just not talk about football. I mean, this was such a huge part of my life. it's, you know, it's sort of intimately intertwined with my experiences in math, and that's what this book was born out of.
Yeah. What do you think that when you, people are reading this book, what are you hoping the takeaway is for them? So when you're writing it, you said, you know what, I want the reader to take away this.
Yes. So there's a bunch of things. First of all, I want the reader to take away a greater appreciation of math. Maybe they didn't like math when they were in school. Maybe they're still in school and they don't quite love math, but maybe this will show them math from a different perspective. I would like them to take away the idea that you can actually be good at sports and good at academics. I'd like them to take away sort of the concept of sort of the power of education, and also that, you know, that they can see what it takes to be really, really good at something and maybe really, really good at multiple things. You need a sort of, you need a great passion. You need determination. You need hard work, and you need resiliency when you face, you know, the many, many setbacks that are going to come your way.
Right. So I have a question for you. You kind of led me to an interesting thought, if you will. You're saying that you can be good at math and you can be good at sports. In this case, you can be good in football. I was never an athlete, so I don't know what it's like to be an athlete. I was only on the academic side. Do athletes have a choice, though, John, right? Like, for that athlete, for that football player who is destined to at least go to a D1 college football program, do they have the choice to do both?
Yes. Yes. That's a sort of conscious choice you make. First of all, I'm going to state the obvious. It's not easy. Mm-hmm. The sort of workload that's asked of you does not make it an easy task, but I'm telling you, it's doable. Not only is it doable, it's crucial. I mean, sports of course matter. Sports are important, but education is the single greatest gift you can give someone. Education is the thing that allows someone to truly change their situation in life in a way that sort of sports, you know, really only claims to.
Right. What do you think, though, the wraparound support services could be needed for that, right? Like, because, it's, you know, you were able to, you know, watch your mother in night court, you know, in law. You were able to see your dad as well. For other individuals, what support is needed for that to happen? Does the schools that the high school quarterback is in, you know, need to make sure that they're surrounded by the best services? Do coaches need to be more cognizant of this? Do parents need to be more cognizant of this? Do you see that the wraparound services are there, or do we need to be advocating for more wraparound services around student athletes?
First of all of the above that you just listed, and I think we really do need to sort of add more resources. One of the sort of biggest problems that I think we face in this country is a lack of educational equity. Mm. And sort of the resources available to a young person really differ based on where they live, and the sort of social culture around education is very different depending on the household they're born into. Mm-hmm. And it's not just a disservice to them. It's a disservice to us as a country, because there are so many bright young people being born into this country that are being lost because they're born into, quote unquote, the wrong household.
Yeah. I love how you frame that with the inequities of education. And that is something that I talk about a lot here at the Mike Muse Show and in my work in advocacy outside of Sirius XM. John, I can talk to you further. I think you and I are just getting started. I would love for you to come back on the Mike Muse Show, man, and we can continue this conversation right where we left off, man. I'm thinking right around college football time, brother.
Yeah, absolutely. This has been a ton of fun, man. Seriously.
Yeah. No, I absolutely love it. John, how can more people connect to you on Twitter, on Instagram? First, I want to encourage everybody once again to go out and buy the book Mind and Matter, A Life in Math and Football with John Urschel. But how can they reach you on Twitter or on Instagram or any other social media capacities?
Yeah, just hit me on Twitter. It's John C. Urschel. That's my handle. And drop me a line and tell me what you think about the things we were discussing today.
All right, folks, I think that is enough smarts for one day, man. Thank you so much for joining the Mike Muse Show. I told you it's going to be wild. It's going to be fascinating. But I think we put it off together, man. I feel a lot smarter, but also feel more drained, though, mentally, trying to get through all this. Until next time, folks, peace.